ఎంత దూరం సరిపోద్దా? హలో, ఐఎమ్ డాక్టర్ శ్రీమన్నారాయణ, అసోసియేట్ ప్రొఫెసర్ సర్జరీ. ఇన్ కంటిన్యూషన్ ఆఫ్ ప్రీవియస్ క్లాస్ అబౌట్ ది డిసీజ్ ఆఫ్ స్క్రోటమ్ అండ్ టెస్టిస్, విల్ డిస్కస్ టుడే అబౌట్ స్క్రోటల్ స్వెల్లింగ్స్. ది ఫస్ట్ టాపిక్ ఈస్ ఎపిడెర్మో ఆర్థైటిస్. ఇన్ఫ్లమేషన్ ఆఫ్ ది ఎపిడెర్మిస్ ఇస్ కాల్డ్ ఎపిడెర్మైటిస్ అండ్ ఇన్ఫ్లమేషన్ ఆఫ్ ది టెస్టిస్ ఇస్ కాల్డ్ ఆర్థైటిస్. బట్ టుగెదర్ దే ఆర్ డిస్కస్డ్. దిస్ ఇస్ బికాస్ ఎపిడెర్మైటిస్ దో కామన్, ద ఇన్ఫెక్షన్ ఆర్ ది ఇన్ఫ్లమేషన్ స్ప్రెడ్స్ టు ది టెస్టిస్ యూజువలీ. దేర్ఫార్ టుగెదర్ వి డిస్కస్ దిస్. అండ్ ద అబౌట్ ది ఇటియాలజీ, ఎపిడెర్మైటిస్ ఈస్ యూజువలీ బ్యాక్టీరియల్ డిసీజ్, వేర్ యాజ్ ఆర్థైటిస్ కెన్ బి బ్యాక్టీరియల్ లైక్ సిఫిలిస్ ఆర్ ఇట్ కెన్ బి వైరల్ లైక్ మమ్స్. Viral disease does not spread to epididymis. Pathophysiology. The path of spread is, it is usually a retrograde infection from the urinary tract. From the urinary tract, from the urethra through the ejaculatory ducts, the vas deferens is infected. From there, the tail of epididymis is infected. When it is hematogenous, that is blood spread, it is the head of the epididymis that's infected first because of its better blood supply. Causes: may young sexually active male person, that is in teens and 20s, it is the usual gonococcal or chlamydial infection, which are usually sexually transmitted diseases. Whereas in elderly people, past middle age, it is either prostatitis, wherein the infection is usually caused by E. coli and Proteus, or some other urinary tract infection wherein instrumentation or catheterization is commonly done. Because it's a retrograde infection from the urinary tract, it spreads to the epididymis through vas. Vasectomy, that means is a small operation wherein the vas is divided and tied, protects the epididymis from retrograde infection. Blood spread: when it is hematogenous spread, acute epididymitis is caused by streptococcal or staphylococcal bacteria, wherein the primary source may be elsewhere. When it's a case of chronic epididymitis, it is usually due to tuberculosis disease or syphilitic or filarial disease. Clinical picture: the disease epididymo architis presents with general symptoms like fever with prostration. Chills may also be present. Locally, it is a painful swelling of the scrotum. Testis and epididymis, if palpated, may be swollen and tender. The scrotum itself shows the scrotal wall is edematous, red and shiny. The rugae are less. There may be lax or small hydrocele, which is soft. Other features of urinary tract infection like burning urination, frequency of urination, strangury, they may also be present. What happens if the disease is left behind? Then the disease progresses and forms an abscess, which may burst open and form a sinus. Once the pus is discharged through sinus, slowly the infection is reduced to chronic stage. During this long duration, the testicular damage may take place and cause atrophy. Inadequate treatment or leftover sinus will result in chronic or recurrent epididymitis. Suppose it is a bilateral case, then the disease results in fibrosis of the epididymis at the various regions of the epididymis. The epididymis has a long convoluted tubule through which the spermatozoa travel. So with the scarring at any spot, will result in blockage of testicular spermatozoal transport. That means if it is a bilateral case, then infertility. Differential diagnosis. All cases which present with serious pain or acute pain in the scrotal region have to be thought of. One is a testicular torsion. This is important because it is a surgical emergency. Second is a small strangulated hernia, again a surgical emergency. A torsion of testicular appendage can also be there. Trauma to testis should also be differentiated. All these present as sudden acute pain in the testis, but none of them have systemic symptoms like fever with chills and rigors. Testicular tumors sometimes are confused because with a small amount of trauma, there may be some bleeding and the presentation is again sudden attack of swelling with pain. Till then, a small swelling is a painless swelling is not noticed by the person. Investigations. It is the ultrasound scan with the Doppler that differentiates all these. It shows that it delineates the testis as well as epididymis. So a tumor or trauma can easily be differentiated. A hernia can also be differentiated. It also shows blood supply, whether the vessels are twisted or not are also shown. That's how the testicular torsion is differentiated. But in a case where a testing is not possible for any reason and a torsion of testis cannot be ruled out, and then one has to proceed thinking it is a torsion because it is an acute emergency and the time lapse should not take place. Testis scrotum has to be explored and testis has to be seen. And further investigation should follow, further treatment should follow. The danger of opening the scrotum in case of acute epididymitis is very less. Nothing happens. But missing a diagnosis of torsion testis, thinking it could be only epididymitis, is always dangerous. If more than 24 hours time is lapsed, testis is going to be necrosed. Second investigation necessary is urinary tract infection, urine routine examination for pus cells as well as bacteria, and culture and sensitivity. To complete the list, fine needle aspiration of the epididymis is also done, particularly in a delayed case wherein an abscess formation is expected and ultrasound scan reveals an aspiration, a small abscess, then fine needle aspiration of that abscess will yield a few drops of pus or fluid which can be subjected to culture and sensitivity. Second, a lax hydroseal, which is a secondary hydroseal, can also be aspirated, but rarely it yields some bacterial infection. Therefore, culture may not be positive. But if it is positive, then definitive treatment can be started. Treatment. The treatment of acute epididymitis is of two steps. One is systemic treatment. Second is local treatment. Systemically, we start immediately broad spectrum antibiotics in case of young adults where it is probably a venereal or sex related disease. Then that means chlamydial infection is a possibility. Then broad spectrum antibiotics like doxycycline or quinolones are started. In case of elderly people where prostatitis is the main disease, then again broad spectrum antibiotic in the form of quinolones are indicated. These antibiotics are given for about 2 to 3 days. By that time, we get culture and sensitivity of the urine. If it yields definite bacteria and sensitivity to specific antibiotics, then the treatment shifts to that specific antibiotic. Anyway, the antibiotics to be given for a minimum of 2 weeks or till the clinical resolution is complete. That means the edema and tenderness completely resolved. Patient is totally comfortable. But histological recovery will take about 6 to 8 weeks. Along with antibiotics, first few days, because we want to relieve him of his pain with analgesics and anti-inflammatory drugs. At the same time, plenty of fluids is advised, because concentrated urine, infection in presence of concentrated urine does not respond to antibiotics easily. Locally, cold compresses are advised over the scrotum. At the same time, Prenz test, which is nothing but an elevation of the testis along with the scrotum, relieves pain in case of epididymitis, and in case of torsion of testis, there is no relief. So using this principle, we give scrotal support and elevate the scrotum and testis to give comfort. If by any chance an abscess has already formed, then incision and drainage, surgical drainage is done. That's the only role of surgery in treating acute epididymitis. Summary of epididymarchitis, acute epididymarchitis. It's a common infection spreads from urinary tract. In case of tropics like India, filarial infection is also quite common. It presents as painful swelling of scrotum along with general symptoms like fever. It's to be differentiated from all sudden painful disease of scrotum like torsion testis injury or strangulated small hernia. Ultrasound scan helps to differentiate these diseases. It's effectively treated with adequate antibiotics. Inadequate treatment may result in chronic disease. Vasectomy protects from retrograde spread. And previously, a few decades back, when prostatectomy is done for benign enlargement of the prostate, always vasectomy is also contemplated in the same surgery. First vasectomy on both sides is done, then prostate is handled. This is to prevent retrograde infection. Then other topics like chronic epididymarchitis, which can be specific or non-specific. Non-specific is due to some bacteria, the same bacteria that causes acute epididymarchitis, wherein the treatment is inadequate. The specific chronic epididymitis is like tuberculosis disease. Non-tubercular chronic epididymarchitis due to incomplete resolution of acute attack. The clinical picture is intermittent or recurrent attacks of mild scrotal discomfort, and minimal fever may be present. But on examination, the epididymis is irregularly enlarged and firm and tender. Of course, ultrasound scan always helps. Treatment is prolonged antibiotic treatment, a minimum of 1 month. If there is no resolution with antibiotics, then surgical excision of either epididymis or including testis, that is epididymectomy or archidectomy, is contemplated. In case of tuberculosis disease, it is always secondary to renal tuberculosis. Clinical picture, it's a mildly tender, multiple nodules on epididymis or vas or felt. It also presents as mild pain or discomfort in the epididymis or in scrotum. When we palpate, the epididymis is irregular with so many nodules producing beading or craggy appearance. These multiple nodules, they are also present over the vas also, giving an appearance of a chain of beads appearance. Occasionally, cold abscess may be present as a soft swelling, which is minimally tender. This cold abscess gets attached to the skin posterior to the epididymis, and slowly this skin is eroded and the cold abscess discharges its contents. And this sinus does not heal and it continues to discharge serous type of fluid. So a sinus behind the testis or on the posterior surface of the scrotum is indicative of tuberculous epididymitis. Rarely when testis is inverted, that is twisted, the testis is congenitally reversed, then the epididymis is anteriorly placed, then a sinus in the anterior portion of the scrotum may be present. Rarely, previously when syphilitic disease was rampant, syphilitic arthritis producing gammas can form a sinus anteriorly over the scrotum. In the past, the dictum was an anterior sinus of the scrotum is a syphilitic disease. A posterior sinus of the scrotum is tubercular disease. This is no longer there nowadays because syphilitic disease is quite rare now. Of course, if you suspect tuberculosis, then other evidences of tuberculosis must be searched. Entire urinary tract should be scanned by ultrasound scan, if necessary, IVP, CT scan also. Chest X-ray, of course, is needed. Ultrasound scan in the beginning itself is needed. Urine can be repeatedly examined. Urine is collected and its sediment is examined for AFB, acid phosphobacilli. Even semen is collected and semen is also microscopically examined for AFB. Treatment, mainly anti-tuberculous drugs, given for a minimum of 6 months. A combination of drugs, anti-tubercular drugs are used. The primary disease in the kidneys as well as in the genitalia have the same treatment. So many of the times the primary disease in the kidney is resolved, but the resolution in the epididymis may not be adequate. So after waiting for 2 months with the anti-tuberculous drugs, if the response is not good, then arachidectomy is performed. But anti-tuberculous drugs are continued till the course is completed. Second topic for today is hydrocele. If you have any doubts regarding this epididymitis, acute epididymal arthritis, please ask. Okay, we'll go to the next topic. Hydrocele. Hydrocele meaning is a swelling containing watery fluid. Definition: an abnormal collection of serous fluid in some part of processus vaginalis that extends from the abdominal cavity at the internal inguinal ring to the bottom of the scrotum. Types of hydrocele are congenital or acquired. Acquired, again, hydroceles may be primary, wherein definitive cause is not identifiable, or secondary acquired hydroceles, wherein a specific reason or cause can be identified. Congenital hydrocele is of mainly four types. The figure shows the first one is a normal structure, wherein the testis is shown as yellow, the epididymis and cord, spermatic cord, is shown as blue structure. The second picture shows collection of fluid in the form of pink and red in the tunica vaginalis. It is called vaginal hydrocele. Third picture shows collection in the tunica vaginalis with extension into the along the spermatic cord into the inguinal canal. Here, the process vaginalis is closed at the internal inguinal ring, but is patent in the some part of inguinal canal as well as around the testis. Fourth picture shows total patency of processus vaginalis. Here the fluid collects from the internal inguinal ring up to the bottom of the scrotum. This is called congenital hydrocele. The third picture is infantile hydrocele. Suppose the processus vaginalis is closed proximally at the internal inguinal ring and distally at the external ring. In between, at some part it is patent, then fluid may collect. That is called hydrocele of the cord. Secondary hydroceles, where a specific reason or cause is identifiable, it's usually due to epididymal or testicular disease. Epididymitis is usually a bacterial infection, whereas testicular affections may be infections like bacterial or maybe due to trauma, torsion, or a tumor. Pathophysiology. In general, the abnormal collection of fluid is due to four reasons. One is there is excessive production of fluid. Normally, the tunica vaginalis sac has two lines. One is a visceral layer, which is fused with the tunica albuginea. This visceral layer is the secreting surface. Whereas the parietal layer, which is attached to the scrotal wall, is the absorbing layer. So normally there is a balance of normally less than 5 ml of fluid is present in the vaginal tunica vaginalis sac. That means it's a potential sac. When due to secondary hydroceles, the production is more than absorption, fluid collects. The extra collection is due to defective absorption, which is the main reason for primary hydroceles. Similarly, in India and other tropical countries wherein the filarial disease is the reason, it is probably lymphatic obstruction that may be the cause. Lymphatic obstruction also results in defective absorption only. Lastly, in congenital hydrocele, there is a connection with the peritoneal cavity and peritoneal fluid slowly drains into patent processus vaginalis up to the root of the scrotum. This is how the abnormal collection of serous fluid develops and hydrocele forms. Clinical picture. In case of primary hydrocele, the hydrocele itself presents as a painless swelling of the scrotum. Because it is painless, a small hydrocele is neglected until it becomes large, moderate size, more than a cricket ball size. The person will not consult. This size of a hydrocele will cause discomfort with the dragging or for exposure purpose. That means through cloths itself, sometimes it may expose. When examined, we want to confirm whether the swelling of the scrotum is confined to scrotum only or descending from inguinal region. So for this, getting above the swelling is the test that is done. It is depicted in the picture. That means with two fingers, we want to define the upper border of the swelling. The swelling is no longer coming from above, from the inguinal canal. If it is coming from inguinal canal, it is probably a case of infantile hydrocele or a case of congenital hydrocele. In case of hydrocele, maybe a case of hernia itself. A primary hydrocele is tense cystic. It's not soft. A tense cyst is sometimes felt as firm, but its liquid content can be determined by doing fluctuation test. It is a fluctuant test. The liquid content is watery like serous because of transillumination. If you do transillumination test, the swelling is transilluminant. Because it surrounds the fluid surrounds the testis and epididymis in the tunica vaginalis sac and tense cystic, then underlying testis and epididymis could not be palpated. In case of secondary hydrocele, it's usually of shorter duration, usually of smaller size. Presentation will be of the main primary cause. It is always tender and painful. The hydrocele is lax and soft. Therefore, testis and epididymis become palpable. Whereas a congenital hydrocele, that means total patency of process vaginalis, it has communication with the peritoneal cavity, but this communication is very small, pinhole like. Therefore, solid contents like loops of intestine or omentum do not descend. That means a hernia does not form. The pinhole communication allows only peritoneal fluid to come down into the scrotum. And so because of this communication, with position of the person, the fluid may transfer into the peritoneal cavity or may come down into the scrotum. As the child lies during the night, slowly the scrotal fluid drains into peritoneal cavity, and by morning no hydrocele can be seen. That means hydrocele appears intermittently now and then, mostly in the evenings. The size is variable, and though it has communication with the peritoneal cavity, it's not reducible because the hole is very small. The process vaginalis layer is very thin layer. If we press the sides of the process vaginalis covering the pinhole, will collapse and no more communication will be present. Therefore, it's not reducible. This is called inverted ink bottle effect. The swelling is always lax, soft, cystic, and testis underneath and epididymis can be felt. Whereas in case of epididymis, in case of hydrocele of the cord or hydrocele of canal of neck in case of females, it presents as a small oval swelling which is painless, and its attachment to the spermatic cord can be determined by pulling the testis down. Then the swelling also descends a little. Its mobility in both directions along the spermatic cord as well as at right angles will be reduced, and more or less that means as long as testis is pulled down, the mobility also is fixed, reduced. Investigations. Hydrocele is mostly a clinical diagnosis. And if secondary hydrocele is suspected, and or if the testis and epididymis clearly could not be tested by palpation, then ultrasound scan is indicated, which reveal the structure of epididymis and scrotum on the testis. Routine examination is done because it can be a chronic epididymitis that is causing hydrocele. Treatment. In case of congenital hydroceles, that means total patency of process vaginalis, though it presents, the disease presents in the newborn period itself, we give a 2 years time because spontaneous resolution, spontaneous closure of process vaginalis is possible and sometimes takes place. Therefore, we wait. At the end of 2 years, if no longer disappears, the swelling is still present, then surgery is indicated. The surgery is to disconnect the process vaginalis from peritoneal cavity, that is, herniotomy is done. In case of adult hydroceles, surgical and non-surgical treatments are available. All secondary hydroceles, we don't commonly treat hydrocele portion because if we treat the primary cause, secondary hydrocele disappears by itself. So we are left with only primary hydrocele and hydrocele of the spermatic cord. Hydrocele of the spermatic cord, appears as a small swelling which can be excised surgically. Whereas primary hydrocele, the treatment is either non-surgical or surgical. Non-surgical treatment is simple aspiration with a wide bore needle. Complete aspiration of the tunica vaginalis should be done. The only problem, if you just aspirate, it recollects again, probably within a week or 2 weeks. Therefore, soon after aspiration, through the same aspirated needle, a sclerosant injection is also given into the tunical sac. This sclerosant solution will cause acute inflammation of the epithelial layer of the tunica vaginalis of both visceral layer as well as parietal layer and form adhesions between them, thus eliminating the sac portion. The sclerosants used are tetracycline, ethanolamine oleate, tetradecyl sulfate, sometimes hypertonic saline also is used. It is about 80% successful, but in 20% of the cases, it's a failure because tunica vaginalis may not be emptied completely. And also when sclerosant injected, the sclerosant may not spread to nook and corner of the tunica vaginalis sac. Disadvantages of this procedure is recurrence of hydrocele. Second, as you are using a large bore needle, as the aspiration is continuing, the sac is collapsing, the needle may injure the testis and produce hemorrhage. So a hematocele formation can be there in the tunica vaginalis. And maybe we are introducing infection, particularly if the needle used is not completely sterile, maybe pyocele may form. Surgical treatment. Instead of doing this non-surgical treatment, which has 20% failure rate, a surgical treatment which is almost 100% guaranteed, this is preferred. The surgery also is a simple surgery only. It can be done under local anesthesia also. The surgical procedure followed depends on the size and thickness of the scrotal wall. If it is a very small hydrocele, then maybe we can ask him to wait since it's not going to cause any symptoms. But if the person insists or it is a little large, then if it is still, the sac is thin-walled, the process vaginalis apparently thin-walled, which can be noted down by doing trans-elimination test. Large plication procedure is followed. The parietal layer of tunica vaginalis is plicated, is folded around the posterior portion of the testis. Here, the tunica vaginalis is not dissected out of other scrotal layers. Therefore, hemorrhage and bleeding will be very less. Second procedure, in case of a moderate size, wherein the fibrosis is added to the tunica vaginalis and it is becomes a little thick, then folding may be difficult. And also the end result, the thickened thickened and bunched, folded tunica vaginalis portion will give the appearance of a small swelling also. Therefore, moderate size of the hydrocele, always we do Jebulase sac eversion operation. Here, the tunica vaginalis sac is dissected all around. It is opened and the edges are folded behind the epididymis and sutured together. Therefore, it is permanently reversed. Now, the secreting surface of tunica albuginea are along with the visceral layer of the tunica vaginalis is exposed permanently to the scrotal layers, which have good lymphatics and good absorption capacity. A large hydrocele, particularly with thick, sometimes even calcified sac, the sac, entire sac is excised completely. It is dissected out and completely excised from the edges of the posterior portion of the testis, where a tunica vaginalis is folded onto the parietal layer is folded onto the visceral layer. There it is completely excised and removed. The edges are bleeding heavily. Therefore, their bleeding is arrested by sutures. Sometimes, instead of excising the whole tunica vaginalis, we can do some partial excision and fold the rest of the tunica vaginalis like Jebulase operation, a combination of the two. Even the scrotum, when it is very large, a portion of the scrotum also is excised in the form of scrotoplasty. See the large splication from the edge of the posterior portion of the testis, various interrupted stitches are applied to the tunica vaginalis. When the sutures are tied, the tunica vaginalis is folded at the posterior lateral portion of the testis. The second picture is Jebulase operation, where the tunica vaginalis layer is reversed and posteriorly over the epididymis and lower portion of the cord, the edges of the tunica vaginalis are sutured together. Complications. The hydrocele has a few complications. As it is, it's not a painful disease, but it may undergo some trauma. A bleeding may occur into it and form hematocele and then getting infected, producing pyocele. Sometimes tense collection may erode into the parietal layer of the tunica vaginalis and fluid may collect subcutaneously. Herniation of the hydrocele can happen. Rarely, tunica vaginalis may rupture. The summary of the hydrocele: collection of serous fluid in the tunica vaginalis sac is called hydrocele. Defective absorption is the main reason for primary hydrocele, whereas excessive secretion is the reason for secondary hydrocele. Defective absorption also includes lymphatic defects, which is the main reason for filarial problem, filarial hydrocele, which is common in India and other tropical countries. Mostly, it presents as a planeless enlarged scrotum. Ultrasound scan rules out testicular and epididymal disease. Aspiration of sclerosant injection is non-surgical treatment. It is done for temporary purpose, particularly if a person is going for selection for army or some other security jobs. There it can be done. Or in a person who is surgically unfit. This is a rare indication because hydrocele can be done under local anesthesia. I'll ask a few simple questions. Please answer them. lax and painful hydrocele in an adult. In what type of hydrocele? This picture is present. Lax and painful hydrocele in an adult. Yes, it's a secondary hydrocele. That means there is some reason like epididymitis or some trauma or some twisting like torsion, something is there. We'll go to the next topic. Next topic is, do you have any doubts in hydrocele? Okay, we'll go to the next topic, that is varicocele. Definition: varicocele is an abnormal dilatation of veins draining the testis. You can see in the first picture, in the normal picture, wherein the pampiniform plexus is formed with thin veins. In the second picture, where the veins of pampiniform plexus draining the testis and epididymis are dilated. This dilatation is called varicocele. Elsewhere, these dilated tortuous veins are called what? Varicose veins. Anatomy. The testis and epididymis is drained by small venules, small veins, which are about 10 to 12. They intercommunicate and form a network. As they ascend along the spermatic cord, at the superficial ring, they intercommunicate with each, and about 8 veins are present. 6 to 8 veins are present at the superficial inguinal ring. But by the time it reaches the pampiniform plexus, reaches the deep ring, they fuse together and form only 2 veins. And deep to the deep inguinal ring, that is in the retroperitoneum, the 2 veins fuse together, form single testicular vein, which ascends straight up and ends on the right side into the inferior vena cava below the level of renal veins. On the left side, the testicular veins ends into the left renal vein. At their termination, a valve is present on each side. Elsewhere, valves are not there in the testicular or pampiniform plexus. Only single valve is present near the termination. Cause for abnormal dilatation, that is varicocele. There can be a congenital defect like incompetent valve or absence of valve. In such case, the hydrostatic pressure of the renal veins may be communicated into the pampiniform plexus on the right side from the inferior vena cava. In case of patients presenting past middle age, all elderly age, maybe the testicular vein is thrombosed or blocked, particularly on the left side due to renal tumor, carcinoma of the kidney. Sometimes post nephrectomy, after nephrectomy, the tied renal vein is thrombosed, and this may thrombus may extend into the testicular vein also. Because on left side the testicular vein ends at the ends in the left renal vein, the varicocele on the left side is more common. Varicocele clinical picture is, it's commonly present in the teens as well as in the young adults. It's mostly asymptomatic, doesn't cause any symptoms. But when examined for some other purpose, this is revealed. The only symptom it may sometimes cause is a dragging pain. This dragging pain is usually present by evening. It is increased by standing position. So by evening, the pain is felt. When dragging pain is felt, if the person immediately lies down, the pain is relieved within a few minutes. Testis apparently hangs down a little lower than the opposite side. If spermatic cord is felt, dilated veins are felt as tortuous vertically running threads like bag of worms. When the person is lying down, the veins drain out and are no longer felt. At this time, if a person coughs and raises his intra-abdominal pressure, temporarily these pampiform plexus of veins, they dilate and produce a cough impulse like a thrill. Always, varicocele is examined in standing position only when the veins are dilated and felt. In long-standing case, testis may become smaller and a little atrophied because of continuous rise in temperature in the scrotum. Investigations. Ultrasound scan with the Doppler is the investigation that is required. This shows clearly the dilated veins. Ultrasound scan in case of middle-aged and elderly people should cover the entire renal system, that is abdomen also, to rule out renal diseases. Depending on the ultrasound scan, varicocele is graded. Subclinical varicocele only seen on ultrasound scan or on thermograph. It's not felt. Clinically, there is no varicocele. Grade 1, when examined in standing position also, the swelling in the swelling in the scrotum is not seen, but only palpable while doing Valsalva. That means Valsalva maneuver means a person trying to exhale forcibly against closed nose. At the time, the intra-abdominal pressure is very much raised. In grade 2 varicocele, again the varicocele is not visible but palpable even without Valsalva. Grade 3, where it is visible as well as palpable. Normally, the pampiform plexus of veins are 2 to 3 millimeter size only. In grade 1, it is between 3 and 4 millimeters, and grade 2 it is 3 to 4 millimeter, 4 to 5 millimeter size, and lastly in grade 3 it is more than 5 millimeter size veins are usually present. This grading is for academic purpose only. Complications. Generally no complication occurs other than continuous pain in standing position, but it may have some relation with the spermatogenesis, which is clearly not defined or identified. The exact relation between varicocele and spermatogenesis is not exactly known, but a correlation between them is known. Varicocele presence of varicocele will increase the intrascrotal temperature, and therefore spermatogenesis is said to be reduced. The semen quality is reduced. This in turn may affect the fertility rate. Treatment. As most of the varicoceles are asymptomatic, and in them fertility is not a problem, or when semen count is normal, sperm count is normal, then we don't advise treatment. We ask them to wait and watch and ask them to return when symptoms appear. All those cases where symptoms are already present, or when without symptoms also, if the person has come for infertility investigation and grade 1 or 2 varicocele is present, then a surgical treatment of varicocele is advised. Wherever facilities are available for interventional radiology, then testicular vein is identified and embolized through femoral vein. If this is not possible, or when recurrence occurs after embolization, then surgical ligation of the testicular vein or tampariform plexus at various regions, either in the retroperitoneum just above the deep inguinal ring, or near the inguinal ring, the tampariform plexus, or in the inguinal canal, middle of the inguinal canal, or near the superficial inguinal ring, the tampariform plexus can be ligated. When tampariform plexus is ligated in the canal or inguinal canal or near the external inguinal ring, we have to protect the testicular artery, and we have to leave behind at least one vein for drainage to continue. That means the surgical drain, surgical complication under these circumstances is ligation of the testicular artery, which results in atrophy of the testis. Such a problem is not there near the deep inguinal ring or in the retroperitoneum. Here, even if by chance testicular artery is ligated, there are collaterals like the testis is still supplied by cremastic vessels or vessel to the artery to the vas deferens. Results. Sperm count and semen quality may improve. It's not definite. But for that, we have to wait for a minimum of 6 months. Recurrence of varicose veins, varicocele is quite common. Summary. Varicocele is an abnormal dilatation of veins of tampariform plexus, which drains the testis and epididymis. The disease is common on left side. Mostly it is asymptomatic, may affect spermatozoal production. Ultrasound scan with Doppler confirms. Requires treatment only when becomes symptomatic or when the semen quality is defective and the person came for infertility investigation. Only treatment is surgical treatment. Some kind of blocking the testicular vein is important, either by embolization or by surgical ligation. Even tampariform plexus of veins itself is ligated. With any treatment, recurrences are known. I'll ask one or two simple questions. Where does the left testicular vein end? Yes, it ends into the left renal vein, whereas on the right side into the vena cava, inferior vena cava. Then, bag of worms is the description given to which structure? Okay. Very good. We'll go to the next topic. Vasectomy. Vasectomy is a simple operation causing sterility in males. Vasectomy means division of vas and ligation of the both ends. Ectomy anywhere means excision. But here we are doing only division, which is called vasotomy. So vasotomy is more appropriate word, but vasectomy is a common word that we are using. It's a simple daycare surgery to create sterility in male person. For all practical purposes, it is a permanent procedure. It's done under local anesthesia. Before undertaking the operation, preoperatively, the couple are spoken to and consent is obtained. Specifically, we stress on 3 points, that it is a permanent procedure and it may cause a little bit of testicular pain postoperatively for a few weeks in some people, and recanalization is a possibility. Two types of vasectomy are done. The surgical procedures are of two types. One is with scalpel, the other is without scalpel. With scalpel, on either side we give a small incision and at the root of the scrotum, and vas is dissected out, and a piece of vas about 1/2 to 1 centimeter size is removed and subjected to histological examination to prove that we have removed vas only. The ends of the vas are tied with non-absorbable material like silk. Sometimes we reverse the end and ligate it. So between the tied ends, the tissues of spermatic cord are interposing. Therefore, the chances for recanalization are very minimal. In case of no scalpel method, where scalpel is not used, but at the median raphe of the scrotum, with a sharp instrument, the scrotum is pierced and it is dilated, and the small tear is made into the scrotum, through which on either side of the spermatic cord is brought near the incision, and vas is separated and excised and ligated. A small portion is excised and ends are ligated. The vas is dissected out and about 0.5 centimeter ligated, subjected for histopathology. Post-operative advice. Apart from routine advice of rest for 1 week and usage of antibiotics and analgesics, we advise them to use temporary methods of contraception for 8 to 12 weeks because vasectomy does not come into effect immediately after surgery. This is because the distal portion of the vas and seminal vesicles have some storage of some spermatozoa, which come out later on with each ejaculation. About 6 to 8 ejaculations are necessary for complete expulsion of spermatozoa. That takes about 8 to 12 weeks. After this period, we do semen analysis. We advise them to undergo semen analysis at least twice and document azoospermia. Then we say the vasectomy is effective and no other contraceptive methods are necessary now. Complications of vasectomy are hematoma formation, because any of the pampiriform plexus of veins may be injured, or the artery to the vas is a thin artery that follows the vas everywhere and may get injured while doing vasectomy. Local infection may take place, or sperm granuloma. If a little bit of sperm semen oozes out, a few spermatozoa come out of the cut end, they may form inflammatory reaction and cause granuloma, which presents as a small tender nodule and this takes about a few months to disappear. And lastly, there is a chance of recanalization, which is very, very rare, maybe 1 in 1 lakh. But this is mentioned to rule out future complications like family disturbances. Reverse surgery, this is possible, but results are not 100% guaranteed. The success rate of reverse surgery depends on the time lapse that has taken place since vasectomy done. There are two types of procedures. One is vasovasostomy, where the cut ends of the vas are dissected out and freshened and again anastomosed to each other. Second procedure is vasoepididymostomy, where the distal end of the vas is freshened and anastomosed to epididymis. Both the procedures, if done under microscope, the success rate is better. Maybe the success rate is much more when done carefully, but conception rate may not be so great. Thank you. Just